Yeah, I'm going to call the meeting to order. Ask you to please stand for the pledge of the flag.
Pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
I'd like to welcome everyone to the regular town board meeting. We have approval of minutes. July 5th, 2016 special meeting, July 11th, 2016 regular meeting. Is there a motion?
Second.
Move to second. Discussion, roll call.
Mr. Russell?
I'm just going to abstain from July 5th. I wasn't present on that meeting. Otherwise, yes.
Mr. McGinnis?
Yes.
Ms. Bunt?
Yes.
Mr. Summerfield?
Yes.
Mr. Randazzo?
Yes. Motion is carried. Public comment on agenda items. Anyone wishing to speak on any agenda item? Yes, Jim?
Thank you very much, Jim McGee, representing State Senator Bill Larkin. He asked me to come here tonight, and if it's okay, I have just a short letter to the town board regarding the intersection Route 94 and Jackson Ave. Supervisor Randazzo, I'm writing this letter to inform Supervisor and Town Council that I've been in contact with the New York State Department of Transportation to discuss the need for a traffic signal at the intersection of Route 94 and Jackson Ave. This intersection has been the cause of many accidents to date, and my office is committed to working with the town to ensure we do everything in our power to have something done in an effort to improve traffic safety at this very dangerous intersection. I included a copy of the letter written to Todd Westhouse, Hudson Valley Regional Director of New York State DOT. I will continue to work with the state and the town of Cornwall moving forward. Please do not hesitate me to reach out to my office on this issue. Sincerely, Bill Larkin.
Thanks very much. Thank you, Senator Forrest.
Thank you.
Any other public comment? Yes.
On resolution number 70 concerning the drainage on Robert Road and Sheldon Drive.
Yes.
I'd like to see possibly get something done this evening to do something. It's just
Bob King.
Bob King.
It's okay. Thank you.
Okay, Bob, thanks very much.
Right.
Anyone else? Okay, hearing no one. The first item we have is the Greater Cornwall Chamber is planning on having a car show on September 4th with a rain date of September 5th. The board actually approved the event last week at the special meeting, but in the interim, the original plan was for the cars to be lined up on Rings, in front of Rings Pond on the grass between the sidewalk and the pond, and there was some discussion about that. I mean, a lot of these cars are classics and some concern for the lawn, but after thinking it through, I think a more realistic approach for the event, to really enhance the event, would be to allow the cars to be parked and displayed on Hudson Street rather than having to drive actually over the park and all. So it would just involve closing that section of Hudson Street from about noontime until 6, and it would make for a much better event and lessen the worry with regard to rain and goose droppings and the lawn. So is there a motion to approve the event to be held with the closing of Hudson Street?
Sure.
Michael, second. No. Discussion? Roll call.
Mr. Russell?
Yes.
Mr. McGinnis?
Yes.
Ms. Bunt?
Yes.
Mr. Summerfield?
Yes.
Mr. Randazzo?
Yes. Motion is carried. Next is on the Eagle Scout project. The project is the Scout is planning on helping to light up the Medal of Honor Memorial. And we met with the Scout. He gave the board an overview of his project. And there's an electrician that's going to be participating with the Scout. It's RPC Electric, LLC. The cost of the electrician is approximately $610. And the American Legion, Cornwall American Legion Post, is going to pay the cost of the electrician. So at this point, there's no expense to the town. I've been in touch with the electrician. He will provide the town with a certificate of insurance. Name of the town is an additional insured. Mm-hmm. So just a motion to approve the work at the Medal of Honor Memorial.
So moved.
Second.
Move to second. Discussion. Roll call.
Mr. Russell?
Yes.
Mr. McGinnis?
Yes.
Ms. Bunt?
Yes.
Mr. Summerfield?
Yes.
Mr. Randazzo?
Yes. Motion is carried. Third item is letter from New York State DEC, annual compliance inspection of the First Cliff Sewer District. On June 1st, 2016, compliance inspection of the above referenced facility was performed for the purpose of evaluating compliance with the speedies permit and Article 17 environmental conservation law. The facility was generally found to be operating in a satisfactory manner and no major deficiencies were noted. They've attached copies of their inspection, and so we just really want to note that for the record. Next is another letter from New York State DEC. It's actually a public notice regarding the Majestic Weaving Corporation, which is probably better known today as 2 Mill Street, and it's regarding inactive hazardous waste disposal site delist notice. The DEC has been overseeing this site with regard to cleanup, and they have determined, based on the information they have, that the site can be delisted with regard to the hazardous waste disposal that was there. So all they're seeking is they have a public comment period that will end August 26, 2016. If anyone wants to provide the DEC with information, we do have the notice available here. We have resolutions on the environmental reviews for local laws number 4 and 5 for the proposed zoning changes pertaining to properties on the east and west side of 9W. I will read the resolution with regard to local law number 4. Whereas the town board is considering the adoption of a local law entitled a local law to amend town code chapter 158 entitled zoning to change the zoning designation of certain real property from suburban residence district 2 SR2 to highway commercial district HC and to change the zoning designation of other real property from suburban residence district 2 to planned commercial development. And whereas this is an action subject to SECRA, and whereas the town board as the sole involved agency assumed lead agency status and caused to be prepared a long environmental assessment form, and whereas the town board previously adopted parts 1 and 2 of the EAF and instructed the town planner to prepare part 3, which is presently before the town board for review, whereas the town board as the sole involved agency in the project has taken the requisite hard look at potential adverse environmental impacts of the project. Now therefore be it resolved as follows. 1, that the town board hereby accepts part 3 of the EAF, and 2, that the supervisor is hereby authorized to sign the completed EAF, and 3, that the project is a type 1 action under SECRA, and 4, that after considering all the information presented to it, including the EAF, the town board hereby adopts the negative declaration attached here to, and 5, that pursuant to General Municipal Law 239, the town board hereby directs that the proposed local law along with the full EAF and negative declaration be submitted to the Orange County Planning Department of Planning for review and comment. Is there a motion on the resolution?
Second.
Moved and second. Discussion?
Discussion, please.
Yes.
We still haven't received any information on the town code that permits schools, private schools in residential districts, but are not permitted in non-residential districts. Is that part and parcel of this, that in which we approve this, that that there will be a change in the zoning that will allow schools and special instruction in HC and EIO districts?
No, what we're doing tonight is just the environmental review. Steve might want to add on to that. We would expect that the actual zoning changes will be before the board to vote on next month for adoption.
Okay, so when we adopt this, we're not necessarily permanently adopting, we're adopting it for advancing to Orange County planning.
Correct, so that can review. So you want to add anything to that?
Well, you're comparing apples and oranges. This is SECRA review, which is environmental impacts of the law as written. And when you're talking about the possibility of allowing schools, at existing schools in HC districts or otherwise change in law, what we should do is you're going to get back a comment from county planning, and then you're going to consider whether to adopt the law as written or whether you want to amend the law and adopt it in some other form. So this only takes care of SECRA review. Next month you'll consider law on the merits, okay, whether you want it as is or whether you want to make changes to it. And of course you'll take into consideration whatever county planning has to say in making that decision.
Will we have your insight before the next meeting? So that we
I've been working on a formal written letter. We've received some correspondence from NEMA's attorneys regarding the possibility of changing the text of the local law, and we've been, you know, working on that going forward. I'll certainly have something for the board in writing prior to, you know, probably prior to having your county planning comments, and we'll certainly have some comment on the county planning comments as well. It might be in two letters, it might be in one, but you'll have that well before you start considering whether to adopt the law or not. Thanks.
Okay. Roll call.
Mr. Russell?
Yes.
Mr. McGinnis?
Yes.
Ms. Bunt? Mr. Summerfield?
Yes.
Mr. Randazzo?
Yes, motion's carried. Next is the secret review EAF on the local law number 5. Whereas the town board is considering the adoption of a local law entitled A Local Law to Amend Town Code Chapter 158, entitled Zoning to Add Certain Uses to the Uses Permitted in the Planned Residential Development PRD District as Alternatives to Planned Adult Communities. Whereas this is an action subject to CECRA, whereas the town board is a sole involved agency, assumed lead agency status and cause to be prepared a long environmental assessment form, EAF. And whereas the town board previously adopted parts 1 and 2 of the EAF and instructed the town planner to prepare part 3, which is presently before the town board for review. And whereas the town board is a sole involved agency and the project has taken the requisite hard look at potential adverse environmental impacts of the project, now therefore be it resolved as follows. 1, that the town board hereby accepts part 3 of the EAF, and 2, that supervisors hereby authorized to sign the completed EAF. 3, that the project is a type 1 action under CECRA. And 4, that after considering all of the information presented to it, including the EAF, the town board hereby adopts the negative declaration attached hereto. And 5, that pursuant to General Municipal Law 239, the town board hereby directs that the proposed local law, along with the full EAF, a negative declaration be submitted to the Orange County Planning Department for review and comment. Is there a motion on the resolution?
So moved.
Second.
Moved and second. Discussion. Roll call.
Mr. Russell?
Yes.
Mr. McGinnis?
Yes.
Ms. Bunt?
Yes.
Mr. Summerfield?
Yes.
Mr. Randazzo?
Yes. The motion is carried. Okay, next is a resolution on vehicle and traffic amendments. There's actually 3 that are proposed to be amended for. 1 is the Bridge Street section that goes from Main Street to Bridge Street where it's blocked off. We have striped out the road area there, and the vehicle and traffic law is proposed to be amended to have no parking or standing in that area. And there were 2 other proposals. 1 is the installation of a stop sign at Station Road in Mountainville. And the other one is a installation of a stop sign on Clara Avenue where it intersects with Holland Road. I'll read the resolution. Whereas the Town Board of the Town of Cornwall has before it a local law amending Section 143 of the Code of the Town of Cornwall entitled Vehicles and Traffic in regard to traffic control at Bridge Street, Clara Street, and Station Road. Whereas to proceed with consideration of the local law, it's necessary to formally introduce it and hold a public hearing upon it. Now therefore be resolved as follows. 1, that the movement of this resolution does hereby introduce the proposed local law entitled A Local Law to Amend Town Code Chapter 143. Entitled Vehicles and Traffic, and 2, that a public hearing on the proposed local law is set for, it'll be September, let's see, what's the regular meeting, is on the 12th?
Yes.
Correct?
It's okay. A holiday, but yes, 12th.
Is that a holiday? No.
What does that say?
Labor Day would be the 5th.
Not here, not for us, okay.
Okay, it will be September 12th at 7 o'clock. PM, and the due notice of the same is directed to be given by publication and posting. Is there a motion on the resolution?
So moved.
Second. Discussion. Roll call.
Mr. Russell?
Yes.
Mr. McGinnis?
Yes.
Ms. Bunt?
Yes.
Mr. Summerfield?
Yes.
Mr. Randazzo?
Yes. Motion is carried. Next item, Robert Road, Sheldon Drive, drainage. There's as the residents who are here tonight know, there's a long history with drainage in that area, and of course it was just compounded recently with the storm that we had about a week ago, which created a lot of problems. in the past, the town has looked at drainage in the area, and there's been, always been question about easements that the town already owns on Roberts Road and Sheldon. So I think the best way for the town to approach this, and I've discussed it with the engineer, with the attorney, and the board, we discussed it at our work session last week, is that we will, and have a resolution to this effect, basically authorizing the engineer to provide preliminary information, and that will be done by actually walking a proposed drainage site that would go from Roberts Road and Sheldon all the way down to either the stream or connecting to Main Street. And the initial report is going to be to identify the best route that the drainage system could go and identify the properties that would be affected in terms of easements to construct such a drainage site. It's not easy to just look at Sheldon and Roberts Road and make improvements there with a drainage system without, in all honesty and fairness, looking at the entire run from Roberts Road and Sheldon to where the water can actually go into either another drainage system or into the Canterbury Stream. Obviously, since Roberts Road and Sheldon was constructed back in the 50s, a lot of homes have cropped up in that area between Sheldon and Clinton Street and beyond. So the town has to really take a look at this from basically from scratch to identify the properties where the potential drainage system could go and report back to the board as to what these properties are, if we currently have any easements, and then the board will decide on how we would proceed. If the board is in favor of proceeding in the direction that the engineer would recommend, then what we do is move ahead to acquire easements that we would have to acquire and authorize the engineer to actually start preparing the engineering work and the plans for an actual drainage system that at some point could be constructed. It doesn't mean it's all going to happen overnight. I'm not going to kid you. This is certainly probably a several hundred thousand dollar project. There's no question about that. But I think the feeling is, and the experience the town has had, is especially when you have instances where we do have the storms that then qualify for FEMA or some other assistance that can come to a community, that if we've done our homework and we're prepared to the point that we have engineering plans and we have a system ready to be built, then we can work with the state and the federal government to try to obtain funds from any allocations that are made so that the town can proceed to build the system. I'll just give you one quick example. So I'm stating fact, and it's based on what really has occurred. Going back decades, we had problems over in the Rose Hill Park Poplar Street area, and the town many times tried to solve the problem over there. Ultimately, we did just what I said. We designed a system that would really solve the problem for the residents in that area that had suffered for decades with serious flooding and damage problems. And I think it was around 2003, 2004, the town did receive funds to go towards a 75%, whatever the amount was, but it enabled the town to go ahead and actually build that system. And the good news is that ever since that system's been in, I haven't heard from anyone that has had any water problems. It's really acted like a straw and taken the water out. And coincidentally, when we were doing that project in 04, I think in 05, the town, I think, handled it very well. Our engineers handled it well. The project was being done on time. The reports were being done the way that they should be. Albany was very happy with the work that the town was doing. And they contacted the town and said, do you have any other projects that are ready to go? They had money that had been allocated to a couple other municipalities, I believe, in Western New York. And they had turned down the funds. And coincidentally, Pat Hines, who had been working on these projects, said, we have Mine Hill Road drainage all engineered and ready to go. And as a result of that, we submitted that and actually received the funding to, again, to do that project. So I think this is a very reasonable, logical approach. It's not going to solve it overnight, but I think that the town's going to move forward in good faith, developing the information, designing a system, and being ready to go for it at some point in the future when, you know, the project becomes feasible. So I think that it's worked in the past. It can work now, and I think this will be the best course for us to follow. So I'll read the resolution. Whereas property owners in the Roberts Road, Sheldon Drive area of the town have requested the town provide relief from the drainage problems affecting their properties. Whereas the town wishes to respond to the property owners, now therefore being resolved as follows. That the town board authorizes the town's consulting engineers, McGowey, Hauser, and Etzel, to make an initial evaluation of properties potentially involved with proposed drainage system. Is there a motion on the resolution?
Second.
Move and second. Discussion?
Do the engineers need comment from the residents to get an idea of which properties to look at?
I think what they're going to look at is what the most logical path or course will be for a drainage system in the area. And then they'll find out what properties would be necessary in order to construct the system and then report back to the board.
Grades are going to play a large part in the downstream.
It will. It will. So
it would help to have the neighborhood. Can you give us some information so we have an idea from on the ground what's going on?
Well, I think initially the engineer is pretty familiar with okay. the work up there. Matter of fact, some of this preliminary work has been looked at, I think, in the past for it. But I think this is to give us the opportunity for them to look at the most logical path with the surveyor, do the research on what properties, where we may already have easements, which we believe we may have some.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
So, and that's certainly helpful. And then once we know what the course will be on it, then we can move forward with making sure that we're going to have the easements for a system that could be destroyed. Sure.
There's 5 days of rain coming up, and I'm very nervous. And all I'm asking is that the town keep an eye on the sewer system, because what happens is it backs up, and that's what happens. Two times we've had water in the house, and we don't get flooded. It's the two times that sewer, the line, whatever, the drainage has gotten clogged and backed up. So if they could just make sure it stays clean so the water can get through.
Yeah, they are aware of it. And one of the things that I was up there, and the highway department was up there, what had happened is that drainage swale that comes from behind the houses, that the water ran so fast that it actually, you know, brought all the stones, rocks, gravel, everything right into the pipe, right into the catch basin, and that's really where everything, you know, overflowed from.
Well, in a bad situation, Eugene Conley and Billy Goldsmith, they did an amazing job. The whole group really came and cleaned up.
They did.
Got the rocks out, so thank you.
They did.
As well as our
neighbors.
Yeah, and now they're very aware of it, and Eugene will be certainly keeping track of that, though. So I thank you, though, for all the information we've gotten, and we definitely will be moving forward to see what we can do with it. John?
Well, actually, it all starts up behind my house and my neighbor's house, and it comes down to my Imagine Ridge Road. There's like about three runoffs or four runoffs over there. And when they fixed it 3 years ago, it was good in the beginning, but a lot more water came down after they did the work than prior to. I don't know the design they did. We're getting more water coming down the ditch between my house and my neighbor's house than ever before, probably twice as much. Well, I know we had a lot of rain the last time, but prior to that, it was always came down nice and easy, but now when it rains, it comes down very hard, very quick.
Well, unfortunately, I think you're absolutely right. But I think at this point we've got to deal with what we have. So we do have that drainage swale that, from what I gather, we have easements for that. So it's a matter of where are we going to take that water, you know, collect it and move it beyond the residences. So thank you. We have a vote. Did we vote on it?
No.
Roll call.
Mr. Russell?
Yes.
Mr. McGinnis?
Yes.
Ms. Bunt?
Yes.
Mr. Summerfield?
Yes.
Mr. Randazzo?
Yes. Motion is carried.
That was John. That was John's last name.
Pardon?
John's last name.
Adams.
Thank you.
Okay. Take care. Thanks.
Thank you.
Okay.
Thank you
very much.
Come again.
Thank you.
Good night now. Thank you. Bye now. Okay. Do have a resolution with regard to request to the Department of New York State Department of Transportation for the study and ultimately installation of a traffic light at around 94 and Jackson Avenue. This is something that the town board in the past have pursued officially, and we have not been successful. I think one of the things at this point in time is that there really is an outcry from the community to really do something to make that intersection safe, which really means the installation of a traffic light and probably turn lanes. A young lady who was involved in an accident there a few weeks ago started an online petition, and I think obtained nearly 1,000 signatures, which I have copies of. I also have been in touch with the Cornwall School District. I have a letter from the superintendent supporting the town board's efforts to have a traffic light installed there, and also one from West Point Tours, who I believe have had a couple of accidents with their buses in the area. And we have the letter from Senator Larkin. I've also had a brief conversation with Senator Larkin and Assemblyman Skoufis, mustering as much support as we can get. And I really think the time has come for the DOT to take a serious look at this intersection with an eye towards making the improvements that are really necessary. I think the thing we emphasize is the high school's been out there for a little over 10 years. When you look at the other direction on 94, we have the train station. So we have tremendous number of commuters that are traveling through the area, sometimes all at the same time as the school, traffic and all. And we really have to, make that intersection safe for everyone. And I think the time has really come. So I have a resolution that I'd like to read. Whereas one of the busiest intersections in the town of Cornwall that does not have a traffic light is the intersection between New York State Route 94 and Jackson Avenue. Whereas there have been a number of traffic accidents at the intersection, and of late, the number of traffic accidents has been increasing. And whereas by this resolution, the town board requests that a traffic light be installed at the intersection. Whereas the town board is aware that the initial step to be taken by the New York State Department of Transportation would be a formal investigation of the intersection. And whereas the DOT requires an official resolution from the town to initiate the formal investigation, and whereas the town board does hereby adopt this resolution and directs that a certified copy of the same be forwarded to the Office of Regional Traffic Safety and Mobility, attention Kingsley Onyek in Poughkeepsie. Now therefore be it resolved as follows, that by this resolution the town board does hereby request the DOT conduct a formal investigation at the intersection of Jackson Avenue and New York State Route 94, with particular reference to the installation of a traffic light at the intersection, and be a further resolved that a certified copy of this resolution be forwarded to the Office of Regional Traffic Safety and Mobility, attention Kingsley Onyek at 4 Burnett Boulevard, Poughkeepsie, New York. Is there a motion on the resolution?
So moved.
Is there a second?
Second.
Discussion?
Did we give the public a timeline? I know this is going to be a... we're dealing with the state, so the process is not going to be immediate. Can you give them an idea of what the timeline is?
It's difficult, but the one thing that I do intend to do is see if, through Assemblyman Skoufis and Senator Larkin, if we can set up a meeting with DOT to really sit down and discuss the intersection and our failed efforts in the past, unfortunately, mm-hmm. To have them take this action. But we have to convince them that the time has come. And I think... given the traffic history which the chief has put together with accidents and just the increased activity in that area for the past decade, that I think that it's warranted, and I'm hoping that their study will do that. But we want to let them know that this is the community. It's not just the town board asking, you know, take a look at this and see what you think.
Now, would you recommend that the public contact this Office of Regional Traffic Safety and Mobility?
I think they can always send letters of support. I have the petition, which clearly has names and I think towns where the people live that have responded to it, and their comments on it as well that came off the website. So anyone that wants to write to the DOT, I will tell you that I will give you the address. The safety director there is Kingsley Onyek, O-N-Y-E-C-H, at 4 Burnett Boulevard, Poughkeepsie, New York. The zip code is 12603, and I would encourage residents to write to them, call their office, and after we adopt this resolution, like I said, I'm hoping to set up a meeting with our state legislators and DOT to discuss this in more detail. So,
and it may just not be a matter of traffic count either, you know, the dangerous condition that exists out there.
There's no question, Kerry, and I think we can all attest to the fact that when we do have to go through that intersection, it is one of the most difficult ones because of the configuration and traffic movements. And even reading some of the analysis that the chief did on the types of accidents, it seems to be an indication where people that are stopped, they start to go because they think it's okay. Mm-hmm. Then they realize that it's not okay, they stop and they get rear-ended. Mm-hmm. So it's a different aspects of the traffic movements that are really, I think, creating a problem. But we don't want to wait till we have a fatality. We really want to get the state on this and ask them for a timely study and response to the town. So,
as a bonus, from the Cornwall train station, there's rarely a break in traffic, especially during rush hour. Mm-hmm. And this will give a break in traffic by stopping traffic there, at least on one side. Mm-hmm. It'll make it a lot more safe and easier for the lot to unfill when the, mm-hmm. the peak trains arrive.
It will. So roll call.
Mr. Russell?
Yes.
Mr. McGinnis?
Yes.
Ms. Bunt?
Yes.
Mr. Summerfield?
Yes.
Mr. Randazzo?
Yes. Motion is carried. I have a letter from the Greater Cornwall Chamber of Commerce. Greater Cornwall Chamber of Commerce having its annual Fall Festival on Sunday, September 18, 2016. Each year the festival gets bigger and better and we try to add new areas and attractions. This year we'd like to use the area on Bridge Street as a seating area for those enjoying the food from vendors. We envision 8 round tables with 10 chairs each plus fall decorations to enhance the area. We'd like to have permission to use this area. Need any further questions? Any questions? Angela Calabro is the contact and Lois Raymond. Is there a motion to approve the request?
So moved.
Second.
Moved. Second. Discussion?
Of course, the local residents will be notified.
Yes. Yes. Well, since the bridge since the bridge is already closed, but yeah, I'm sure the chamber will make the notification, which I think they're going to do for Tory again. As well.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Rich said he's going to do it in advance.
Yeah, so that the residents are. Okay, roll call on.
Mr. Russell?
Yes.
Mr. McGinnis?
Yes.
Ms. Bunt?
Yes.
Mr. Summerfield?
Yes.
Mr. Randazzo?
Yes, motion is carried. Next, I have a letter regarding the Cornwall Walk / Run for Cancer. Please accept this letter as a request for approval for the Cornwall Walk Run Cancer to be held on Sunday, October 9, 2016, at 9:30 a.m. at Riverlight Park. It's been a popular and community-driven event in Cornwall for over 11 years. We'd like to continue to raise awareness and honor those who have struggled with this disease. I will advise Chief Hazard, Highway Superintendent Eugene Conley, and Little League President John Carnwright. Please see the attached map of the 5K, 10K course. Insurance will be provided. Please find my public event permit included. Please consider granting me a waiver for the $50 fee so we can keep our costs at a minimum. Thank you for your anticipated support. This exciting community event, sincerely, Neil J. Wilkinson. I don't believe there is a $50
there
charge anymore, so
isn't.
That's not a factor. Is there a motion to approve the event?
So moved.
Second.
Second. Discussion? Roll call.
Mr. Russell?
Yes.
Mr. McGinnis?
Yes.
Ms. Bunt?
Yes.
Mr. Summerfield?
Yes.
Mr. Randazzo?
Yes. Motion is carried. On the proposed wall ball court, we have received the revised engineer's drawing, which reflects the changes that the board had requested for the project. So we just want to note that for the record. And I will advise Jackie that we received the revised drawing. Next, I have a letter from Mr. Loeb. Dear board members, you've asked my firm to review the possibility of the town establishing a heating oil plan similar to the one adopted by the town of Cortland and to report our findings to you. I reviewed the material from the town of Cortland as well as from other towns in Westchester which have established similar plans. All of the towns are considerably larger than the town of Cornwall. The town of Cortland has more than 32,000 inhabitants. The Cortland plan is generally administered by a full-time purchasing department. My initial concern was and remains that there is no statutory authority which provides the basis for a town establishing such a program. I've spoken with the Association of Towns in Albany and they were unable to cite me to any authority which would support the establishment of such a program. As you know, the powers of a town are those granted to it by the New York State Legislature. Neither I nor the Association of Towns have identified any grant which would support the establishment of a heating oil plan such as the one established by the town of Cortland. Very truly yours, James R. Lowe. So I note that for the record. Under personnel, I have memo from Eugene Conley, Superintendent of Highways. He would like to move Edward Weber Jr. to fill the vacant sanitation driver position. Mr. Weber has a Class B CDL New York State license, and the position is currently funded in the 2016 budget. Is there a motion to approve?
So moved.
Second.
Second. Discussion? Roll call.
Mr. Russell?
Yes.
Mr. McGinnis?
Yes.
Ms. Bunt?
Yes.
Mr. Summerfield?
Yes.
Mr. Randazzo?
Yes, and motion is carried. Second item the superintendent's asked us to look at, we would like to, he's recommended that John Frober, F-R-O-E-B-E-R, as sanitation laborer. He conducted the interviews and is recommending Mr. Frober be appointed to the position. He can start immediately at $19.81 per hour. Funds are available in the 2016 budget. Is there a motion to approve?
So moved.
Second.
Moved second. Discussion. Roll call.
Mr. Russell?
Yes.
Mr. McGinnis?
Yes.
Ms. Bunt?
Yes.
Mr. Summerfield?
Yes.
Mr. Randazzo?
Yes. Motion is carried. Two items I just want to mention. Number one is the front steps of the town hall. We had the engineer do the engineering on the replacement of the steps. We went out and received a quote. I think we had four contractors we had sent it to, and only one had responded. But we've had the engineer take a further look at it, trying to come up with the best solution for replacing the steps and installing the new handrails. So I was hoping to have something for tonight's meeting. I don't. The engineer is still working on putting together what would be the best proposal for it, but it's something that we want to do as soon as we can. So I just want to update the board on that. The other thing I just want to comment on is the St. Luke's Cornwall proposal to close the emergency room. I mean, as a board, we certainly have a difficult time accepting that this is a done deal, although the hospital has indicated this time around, as opposed to 3 years ago, that they are not going to reverse their decision to close the ER. We've expressed our dissatisfaction with the way that the St. Luke's Cornwall Hospital administrators really presented this proposal to the community, in the fact that it was presented as we've already made the decision and this is going to happen effective October 1st. We should have been given an opportunity at some time prior, whether it was a month before or 2 months before, because certainly this was in the works within the hospital organization, but an opportunity to sit down with the hospital to really discuss their plans of closing the emergency room, see what alternatives might exist, and to to further express our concern for an emergency room that's been there for probably 90 years, that the community, not just Cornwall, but the greater Cornwall community has come to rely on in so many ways. I was speaking with some senior citizens the other day, and they actually are fearful. I'll be absolutely honest with you. It was comforting to them to know that there was an emergency room that was nearby and easily accessible in the event that they needed any kind of emergency services. So it is very disappointing with the, with the fact that the hospital has not even been able or willing to engage in any discussion. I am going to be meeting with one of the administrators within the next few days. I'm also discussing this with our other elected officials. And I think we have to stress with the St. Luke's Cornwall Hospital that we find that our area of their service area is now really being neglected. I strongly want to say, having lived here all my life and born in the Cornwall Hospital, not that I have that attachment to it, but it's always been a good facility. It's just, unfortunately, when we look back on what happened, and it really, I don't mind saying this, I've said it to the hospital administrators and members of the board that I've talked to, the trustees, that this merger of the St. Luke's Cornwall Hospital actually was a takeover. When they started this a dozen or so years ago, their promise was that it was going to be great for both facilities. It was going to be better for the communities. And in fact, not long after they completed the merger, they started to dismantle the Cornwall Hospital, little by little. They started on the third floor with the operating rooms and said these operating rooms are too old and too expensive to refurbish, but we have great operating rooms in St. Luke's, so we're going to do all our surgeries in St. Luke's in Newburgh. Then it was we had too many inpatient beds and that they had to cut a number of beds. So they went ahead and they cut the inpatient beds. And then it was, we don't need any inpatient beds. We have good beds up in St. Luke's and Newburgh, and the patients can go there. And as a result of this dismantling of our hospital, they did away with a lot of other services that certainly were available to the community. Now, they've promised us that they're going to grow and expand the facilities there, and we appreciate that. We appreciate the fact that there are some services that they have put into the hospital, and I use that word really reluctantly because it really is no longer a hospital. It hasn't been a hospital for years. But they actually owe the Cornwall community, the greater community, much more than what they've really been providing and what they're promising. And I think that they have to be more forthright with the community. I saw at the two meetings that I went to that they have a 5-year sustainability plan. You know what? Let's see that 5-year sustainability plan. I want to see how they're going to sustain the services at the Cornwall campus, as they refer to it, and how they're going to grow and expand those services. In addition to the medical aspects of this, the fact that we have a building basically sitting there totally underused, I want to see what their plans are going forward for that campus. And I don't really want to come across as being critical of the hospital, but I can tell you I'm very disappointed in how they really have handled this whole thing. And while they believe it's a done deal, and when the state health department apparently puts its stamp of approval on it, it probably will be a done deal. But you know what? As a community, we have to fight for services that we feel we're entitled to in our community and for our residents and all. So it's not something that we're going to just let slide. As I said, I continue to talk to some of our elected officials, and we want open dialogue and communication with the hospital. At a minimum, they owe that to the communities that they serve. They say that they're part of this community, then they should act like they're part of this community. And they should keep the public informed of what they're doing. It's not a closed private business venture in the sense that they can keep everything close to the vest. People are counting on their services, relying on their professionalism, and they have to deliver for the greater Cornwall area. So I just want to tell you, it's frustrating to hear that news from them and disappointing, but I, as well as the other elected officials, have expressed this to the hospital people, and we're going to look for some more open dialogue going forward. So I just want to let the public know that we are not happy at all with the way that we have been treated by the St. Luke's Cornwall Hospital, and that we are going to continue to stay after them to make sure that they are going to expand and provide the services that that we need in Cornwall. But the ER is a huge loss for this community. It's a huge loss for the EMS personnel who have to provide a service, and instead of being able to come to Cornwall, they're going to go to Newburgh. And we heard stories at the hospital town hall meeting a couple weeks ago how there'll be 5 ambulances lined up out there waiting to be able to unload patients, and the downtime that these EMS people are going to experience as a result of this change. And one last comment I'll make is I think the short-sightedness on the part of the hospital to not address this kind of a closure to integrate this service into St. Luke's Newburgh campus. I haven't heard of any real changes that have occurred to accommodate this additional demand that's going to be placed on that emergency room. So I think they have a lot of explaining to do to the community, and I think we want to hear from them, not in closed meetings. I think they should come out publicly and come out and lay out and list publicly what their plans are going forward with the hospital services in our area and the use of the Cornwall campus facilities. So I will now, since I've had that comment, and I'll have committee reports.
Just add to that one comment.
Oh, go ahead, Peter, please.
Conversation, maybe you could bring up the fact that they have a tax exempt status, and that's based on service to the community, and how they still continue to justify that if they're going to open up a medical office park where a hospital used to be. Highland Falls is even the worst position that we're in because they have to go over the mountains.
No question.
And still make it to St. Luke's. So they've just doubled their response time.
No question at all. But, no question at all.
I would question the continuation of their tax exempt status for the Cornwall campus. Mm-hmm.
Committee, anyone else? Committee reports, Helen.
Okay, the senior activities, I see they've headed a Tai Chi. They're going to the River Rose Boat Ride next Monday. And I believe we are working with Valerie also to see how we can improve and increase our services to the seniors. So we might have more on that next month. As for Gary and the building department, permits issued 23, CCs 10, COs 1, on-site inspections 39, complaints 4, stop work order 1, fire inspection 3, signs removed 17, permit fees were $6,293.50, fees for municipal search 3,000, planning board projects opened 2, and zoning none. And then COVAC had 75 calls.
Anything further? Michael?
There have been some changes in Verizon's programming that's coming up. As of August 1st, Channel 20 was replaced from Mundo Max to American TV. That's mostly Spanish-speaking language channels. On August 31st, WRNN Arise News on 481 will be removed from the lineup. On October 1st, there's a number of changes going on October 1st. So what I'll do is I'll ask the webmaster to post these changes on the website, and anybody who has questions can refer to that. For the Conservation Advisory Committee, they met on August 3rd. We had a recap of the board session work. Fall cleanup is underway. Plans for the fall cleanup is underway for Route 218. Keep America Beautiful recycling grant update we got from Carla. She's working closely with Eugene to distribute the recycling bins around the town. I think there's a total of 40?
No.
No, 28, 32.
Well, are they going to make a snap to that, the Snapple program?
Yeah.
We are going to have 12 that are being donated through the grant from Snapple, and we are purchasing 4, so it'll be a total of 16. That we'll have.
And on that topic, I bought the first 2 recycling bins from Town Hall.
That's right.
Well, that's the ones that we're providing.
Yes.
Yes. That's true. Now, let me just expand on that a little bit. We purchased 45 blue recycling containers to make them available to any resident who would be interested at a cost, at our own cost. They would only pay $20, which is just what we paid for them. But the bins really lend themselves to the recycling part of it. So taking off on that, they can come to the town clerk's office to purchase the recycling bin for a cost of $20, and they will be very happy with the service they'll get from that container. So
had we asked Mr. Loeb, we probably wouldn't have been able to do that program.
No, actually, he's supportive of the recycling.
Hector bought one too.
We did get to do an update with the trail conference. The greenway, the proposed greenway from Cornwall out to Chester is continuing its very slow churn. I've met with New Jersey New York Trail Conference, Orange County Department of Recreation, Orange County Citizens Foundation Pathway Group, Orange County Land Trust, the Ogden Foundation, Hudson Highlands Land Trust, Orange County Transportation Council, and a number of different conservation advisors to help start the process of evaluating whether this can actually happen. So just to let you know that is an ongoing effort, and the Conservation Advisory Council is very supportive of that. The beach was closed in by the Beaver Dam.
Lake.
August 1st, when 12,000 gallons of untreated raw sewage overflowed from the town of Windsor sewage system into the Beaver Dam Lake. The beach was closed for several days. And as a matter of fact, today the beach was closed again because of a harmful algae bloom. Mm-hmm. The EDAC met on Wednesday, July 28th. We reviewed Chairman Bill Brain and Anthony Davidowitz's meeting with Supervisor Randazzo for general EDAC discussion. We also reviewed with the Chamber regarding the Chamber of Commerce meeting with Supervisor Randazzo regarding the Bridge Street project. The Chamber has offered to create a seating area, something like a mock-up of what a pocket park might look like on Bridge Street Bridge. A lot of suggestions and discussions regarding the mission statement. The mission statement has been delayed again until next month as we further refine the language to make sure that that we're all in agreement on what the mission and the procedures and meeting bylaws are. And the concern with them is they're not certain exactly how they're going to be presenting information, whether it's bare bones, whether it's providing multiple options, whether there's cost-benefit analysis. They have a lot to suggest and recommend, and their frustration is that until this document is finished, they really can't deliver what they want to deliver to the town. It's a very talented group of people, and they're all very excited at the prospect of participating and recommending different projects and different opportunities for the town of Cornwall as regards economic development. And that's it. At the next work session, I'll present the complete package of information on the heating plan. And hopefully that the inquiry that Mr. Loeb is making isn't going to bring down anybody else's programs. This is all based on memorandum of understanding, not the contract. So I'm not sure if he's completely aware of how the program works, but I'll certainly reach out to the town of Cortland and see what their perception is and how they found a way to make it work for their town and save their residents money on heating oil during the winter.
Well, by all means, whatever you want to pursue, but I certainly understand what Mr. Loeb is saying with regard to he's unable to find anywhere in the law that permits the town to do that. That doesn't mean other towns can do things. They have attorneys as well. We have an attorney who's been a municipal attorney for 50 or 60 years who has done the research and provided the board with his opinion that there is no provision in the law that allows the town to establish that program. So you can pursue whatever you want, Michael, but as of the advice of counsel, it's not something that we're going to pursue. Peter?
For the police department, July of this year, there were 766 calls for service. There were 25 motor vehicle accidents reported, 36 alarms, both residential and business. There were 16 requests for an ambulance, 13 animal complaints, 18 disabled vehicles, over 40 house checks, and 15 assists of other agencies. I have nothing else from the police department. From the sewer department, we already went over the fact on the annual compliance inspection on Firthcliff was successful. And also for Firthcliff, there was routine maintenance and all measured parameters were within permit limits. For the Shore Road facility, also routine maintenance and all measured parameters were within permit limits as well. Recreation, I have nothing to report other than the pool is very full and the men want to be in this.
That's good. Karen?
The highway department for the previous month assisted building and grounds with the cleanup and 4th of July festivities, continued to work on the rain garden project at town hall, roadside mowing and weed eating in town, various locations, patching townwide, sweeping the roads for preparation for tar and chip, various locations, start of tar and chip in various locations, especially several in the center of town recently. Assisted sanitation department with refuse and bulk pickups, installed missing and or damaged street signs, litter patrol townwide, and they continued with catch basin repairs where needed. The assessor's office is on track to finish the entering of all the data for the townwide revaluation. At the present time, the entire village properties have been entered, and they're working on the balance of the town. And they're working with our subcontractors.
Right.
Councilor.
We're hoping to keep that on schedule. I mean, it's important that the revaluation go forward, but I have also emphasized that, you know, quality and accuracy is paramount in having credibility in this, all the work and effort that's going into it. And so we want to maintain that. We're working hard to stay on schedule with it, and hopefully, you know, we'll be able to have that go into effect with the May 1st roll next year. Okay, we have warrant number 8. Is there a motion?
So moved.
Your second?
Second.
Discussion? Roll call?
Mr. Russell?
Yes.
Mr. McGinnis?
Yes.
Ms. Bunn?
Yes.
Mr. Summerfield?
Yes.
Mr. Randazzo?
Yes. Motion is carried. Public comment? Any items? Yes.
As a trustee of Santrank Homestead, I would like to again thank the town board for completing the homestead, having it opened. We, just this past week, had the village camp and the town camp students from 5th grade till 8th grade go through the program. Since they were not able to go through the program when the building was closed, we were able to bring them in last week. We had 135 children go through the camp in 2 days, and they had a wonderful time. And the best part of it was they really started communication between the students and their parents. It was great to be able to, at the farmer's market, have children come up to me and say, "Oh, you're the lady who we did this project with." And their parents who were shopping said, "Oh, you did that? I made this when I was there." So the tradition is continuing through the town, and I just want to again say thank you on behalf of the trustees.
Thank you. Anyone else? Yes.
Can I come over there?
Sure. Yeah. What is your name?
My name is Annie Romano. I own Puppy Paws.
Okay.
I have a little situation going on, and I don't know if this is the right place or time, but I absolutely needed to be here tonight. I need to let you know the abuse of power that your building department, Gary Vincent, has approached me with. He stopped work order on something that I did not start. And he is being very abusive, intimidating, I think because I'm a woman, from the very start of my existence at Puppy Paws a few years ago, through today, this morning actually, when he did issue the stop work order. I'm really upset about it. I have nothing else. I have a whole big thing here, you know, that I wrote 3 pages. It took me an hour and something to put together. And I'm thinking, that's not right. I need to come here, and I need you to feel my intimidation. I need you to feel how he abused me, basically, today, and doesn't allow me to enjoy the fact that being 3 years in this community, I'm able to grow as a business. And I think that that's something that we should all be proud of, that our businesses are allowed to grow. Mm-hmm. And with him not helping me, but hindering me, and intimidating me because I think I'm a woman, the way that he spoke to me and the use of language that he approached me with today, how he would not approach me in public, only in private behind the doors of my store, how he went into my shop that I am currently renting but have not acquired as far as being Puppy Paws yet, and he trespassed in there and told me that he took pictures and tried to tell me that he was going to see me in court. I think that that was really an abuse. I think he needs to be retrained, if nothing else. I think he needs to have a little sensitivity training as well, especially being in the position that he's in. There's obviously something not correct with him. And I know that this is a he said, she said thing, but it's in black and white, and I have pictures too. And I needed to bring this to your attention, as I hope you're his boss. I think you are. I think that you can oversee this project. and I'm asking, if nothing else, to have someone oversee my situation rather than him. I feel very uncomfortable using him,
okay.
And I don't want to go forward with this.
All right, do you have something you want to give to the board?
I have to sign my stop work order if you want to see that.
Do you have any papers, any kind of statement that you want to?
Yeah, I wrote today, yes.
Yeah,
you're comfortable reading it?
I'm not going to read it, but I will take it, and I'll give the board members copies of it.
I'd appreciate it.
Okay, and then we will certainly take it up with the building inspector.
Thank you so much.
And I thank you.
Thank you, appreciate it.
Thank you. Anyone else? Yes.
May I just take a minute to introduce myself?
Yes.
My name is Jay Zhang. If you can ever spell it, just remember the big J. That's what everybody calls me, letter J. And I am the new superintendent of NEMA. This is my third week on the job. And I want to borrow a couple words from Supervisor Rin Denzel about the hospital. When you talked about being a community member, you have to act like a community member. So that's my first step. Like to let you know that I want to be a real community member. I 3 weeks ago, I just retired from the New York City school system as the principal of Stuyvesant High School. So I have a recent graduate. He's not my son, and he's not my bodyguard. Yeah. He's actually helping me with something happening at NEMA tonight. So I reach out to my recent graduates, and I have one here helping me tonight. And so I want everybody to help us to rebuild. You know, I really know that there are so many challenges that I'm faced, you know, coming from a school of 3,300 to a school of 10 as of June, if you heard. But some good news, we're about 20 by now, so we are making every effort to recruit. And last Saturday, we had the most wonderful, the biggest ever open house. So we have, I think my coming on board has generated a lot of inquiries and traffic, so we're taking that momentum, hoping to move forward. So today, I just got my business cards. So I'm a real superintendent today, so I will, you know, love to give you one. And the first thing to do is open our door. If you ever wish to visit our campus, I'll be happy to tour you around to see what looks like inside. That will be my first action, and I hope really to enjoy. I am enjoying the view here for sure after living in Queens for 31 years, and I want you to know that I want to be part of this wonderful community. Thank you.
Thank you, and welcome. Anyone else? Hearing no one, is there a motion to adjourn?
Second.
Roll call.
Mr. Russell?
Yes.
Mr. McGinnis?
Yes.
Ms. Bunn? Mr. Summerfield? Mr. Rendezza?
Yes.
Yes.
Motion is carried.
Yes.
Thank you. Thank you for coming.
What's up, Mike? No.